Since the beginning of scientific discovery, the human race has collectively wondered what it is that makes us unique, what separates us from all other life on the planet. The discovery of DNA in 1869, the development of classical genetics, and research of how our bodies work have all led us to this point in human history, the complete sequencing of all the genes in our bodies. The first whole genome of an organism, the virus phage phi X174, was sequenced in 1977. The same year, the chain termination sequencing method was developed by Fred Sanger. In 1988, the Human Genome Project began, and after its completion in 2003, second and third generation sequencing technologies arrived on the market. With the improvements in this field, the cost per genome has declined dramatically. Advances in genome sequencing have already brought about major changes and created the potential for a bright future in many fields. Over the course of this video, you will be guided through the process of reaching this point, gain an understanding of how the technology works, and learn a little more about the potential benefits, advances, and downfalls made possible by the possession of such a powerful technology. In this segment, we will be discussing the three generations of gene sequencing technologies and the specifics on how a few different methods work. We will begin in 1977 with the development of the chain termination method of gene sequencing, or the Sanger method. Chain termination relies on the use of dideoxynucleotides, also known as DDNTP. These are nucleotides that have a hydrogen group as opposed to the typical hydroxy functional group at the 3' end of the molecule. The process begins with DNA being broken with restriction enzymes, creating fragments that are replicated through the polymerase chain reaction method, or PCR. These fragments are placed in solution and heat denatured, while primers are annealed to strands of DNA that are fixed to a template. Either these primers or another nucleotide are then labeled using fluorescence or a radioactive element. This solution is then placed in four different tubes, each denoting a different nitrogen base. Each tube contains the DNA polymerase, all four nucleotides, and one of the four DDNTPs, the latter of which serves to randomly terminate the replicating chains by preventing more nucleotides from bonding to them. Various lengths of DNA are created by this process, and they are all then denatured again. Finally, this denatured DNA is run on a polyacrylamide gel tray, where electrostatic forces cause the fragments to travel across the gel. The travel distance is a function of the fragment length, where the shortest fragment travels the farthest in the gel. To decipher the sequence, the gel is exposed to UV light, enabling the viewing of bands. As a result, the gel can be read from one end to the other. The bands are then combined to form a single sequence including all nucleotides. This was the first practical sequencing method, and despite its low output and accuracy, several new methods have directly developed from the advances made by the Sanger method. Roche's 454 genome sequencer FLX took the Sanger method and greatly simplified the preparation process. This sequencer became widely available as a commercial product in 2005. Roche utilizes adapter-flanked fragments attached to etched fiber chips to hold primers and polymerase enzymes and start the synthesis of complementary strands. The 454 sequencer also uses emulsion PCR amplification, which replicates the strands attaching to the beads. This ensures that the reaction can be detected at a given light intensity. The sample is then loaded onto a picoteater plate, where the beads enter individual wells. Packing beads are added to wells to aid the spectrometer in reading the sample. In the end, the 454 can analyze a large number of samples in parallel, vastly improving output compared to the original Sanger method. However, the 454 in most cases is unsuccessful in dealing with homopolymers, leading to a greater error rate. It is also more expensive to sequence per base than some of its competitors. Illumina also relies on the chain termination method. Their current sequencer, the HiSeq 2000, integrates improvements in engineering that have given it the highest output currently on the market. Similar to the other methods, the DNA is first broken into fragments, and in this case run on a gel tray to separate them based on size. A 200 to 300 base pair fragment is then selected from this for further replication through PCR. Illumina uses this automated cluster generation to distribute its fragment library to the surface of a flow cell amongst a forest of adapters. A process known as bridge amplification occurs, allowing the generation of copies of a specific molecule to be made on the surface. As each new base is added, a camera records the location of each cluster by capturing the fluorescent signal emitted by the cluster. The combination of these images creates the sequence. Although adding and sequencing one base at a time seems extremely slow, each flow cell analyzes approximately 150 million of these clusters, making it an extremely efficient system. Applied biosystems, however, bring something a little different to the table. The solid system is considerably flexible in that it allows for genome sequencing in different applications. The primary steps are enzyme and sample preparation, PCR and substrate preparation, ligation, imaging, and data analysis. Enzyme and sample preparation and data analysis are the only steps that need to change based on the application desired. Solid uses emulsion PCR amplification, similar to Roche, but it distributes its fragment library onto microbeads that can vary in size and richness of slides they are on. Based on the targeted application, slides containing 1, 4, or 8 sections can be used. Fluorescence is then emitted when each fragment is ligated onto a single strand sequence. Data analysis is accomplished through exact call chemistry, which relies on an 8-base interrogation system with 4 different colored primers to map out possible combinations within the sequence. The system detects single base insertions, deletions, and SNPs with ease. Third generation sequencing technologies include Helicos True Single Molecule Sequencing and the Pacific Biosciences Single Molecule Real-Time Technology. The Helicos single molecule sequencer actually allows for sequencing without PCR amplification of the DNA, enabling shorter preparation times while decreasing the chances of error. First, the DNA is broken into fragments of 100 to 200 nucleotides each. A poly-A tail is attached to the 3' end of each fragment, in addition to a fluorescently labeled nucleotide. These fragments are hybridized onto the surface of a flow cell, which contains immobilized oligo-T nucleotides complementary to the poly-A primer. DNA polymerase and fluorescently labeled nucleotides are introduced into the flow cell, where the nucleotides are added one at a time complementary to the template fragment. Similar to Illumina's method of sequencing, a laser is used to illuminate the surface of the flow cell and capture the fluorescent signal emitted. However, Helicos records the addition of each nucleotide on a single DNA fragment, as opposed to Illumina's cluster-based sequencing system. This allows for billions of unique fragments to be independently sequenced at the same time. Unfortunately, the Helicos sequencer does rely on the heavy use of reagents, which constitutes an ongoing expense. However, it has been shown to have nearly 100% accuracy because this sequencer does not involve PCR amplification. Pacific Biosciences has developed single-molecule real-time DNA sequencing technology, also known as SMRT. First, fluorescence is attached to nucleotides, creating phospholinked nucleotides with a different color for each of the 4 nitrogenous bases. However, unlike the previous methods, the fluorescent label is attached to the terminal phosphate of the nucleotide instead of the base. This allows DNA polymerase to cleave the fluorescent label off during base addition, and this emits a light that can be captured in a nanophotonic chamber. The SMRT sequencer uses zero-mode waveguides, which are essentially small pores that are surrounded by metal film and silicon dioxide that enables the detection of single molecules while DNA polymerase replicates the chain inside the well. As a result, this method allows for simpler and faster genome assembly than comparative technologies, while allowing for longer read lengths. Along with the biological and chemical methods we have just described, the ability to sift through and process the information received is key. Two main algorithms used to process this data at the present time are BLAST and CLUSTAL-W. BLAST stands for Basic Local Alignment Search Tool, which uses a heuristic method that gives it a high search speed in searching for sequence matches. On the other hand, CLUSTAL-W, which stands for Cluster Alignment Interface with Weights, is used for multiple sequence alignment. Multiple sequence alignment is the arrangement of sequences of DNA to compare the similarities of functional regions. The following is a tutorial on how to use BLAST to find the corresponding protein for a sequence of nucleotides. First, we have the DNA coding sequence. This sequence is then transcribed into the mRNA template sequence. Notice that this sequence contains the letter U, which stands for the base uracil, instead of the letter T, which stands for thymine. This is due to the fact that thymine is only found in DNA, not RNA. The mRNA is then translated into the amino acid sequence. For this example, we only need to translate the first 50 amino acids to get the name of our protein. The universal genetic code can be used to decode the three-letter codons in the mRNA sequence. We can decode the three-letter codon AUG by looking at the corresponding parts on the chart. In this case, we have the amino acid methionine, denoted as M in our amino acid sequence. The other 49 amino acids are found in the same way, and each letter stands for a different amino acid. Copy the amino acid sequence. Go to the following website, blast.ncbi.nlm.nih.gov, which is a site provided by the National Institute of Health. On this website, we can search within a particular species, or choose a specific computational program based on whether we have a protein or nucleotide sequence. We will choose Protein BLAST because we are looking for a specific protein based on the amino acid sequence. Paste the sequence where it asks for the accession number, or FASTA sequence. Notice that you also have the options to upload a file, name your BLAST search, or enter more than one sequence in order to align them with each other. For this example, we will only use one sequence. You can also choose a different algorithm based on your sequencing need. When we click BLAST, we can see that our sequence translates to the human protein, insulin, in addition to learning which family of proteins it belongs to. Click on the protein for more information, a description of its domain, and the references used to display the information. Algorithms are continuously under development, and it is thought that the future of this field lies with improving the statistics model used in the algorithms, as well as increasing the sensitivity of the algorithm in evaluating the probabilities of certain base combinations.